Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to make a short statement.
In the world of royal servants, there are few more controversial figures than Paul Burrell.
I think Paul is a fascinating character.
As Diana's butler and footman to the Queen, he served the royal family for over 20 years.
Only one man in history has ever served and been close to the Queen for 11 years and Princess Diana for 10.
But Burrell was no ordinary staff member. He was a former insider who went on trial for theft from his employers and was cleared.
Is this what you expected?
Of course it is.
But who now enjoys a lucrative life of celebrity.
Honestly, Paul, isn't it about the money?
It is not about the money.
But how did the man handpicked by the Queen have such a meteoric rise to fame? How did he secure the trust of Princess Diana? And was he really privy to the royal's greatest secrets? With access to his family.
He is very loyal.
His supporters.
Paul was a keeper of her secrets, there's no doubt about it.
And his critics.
They watch him, but they don't trust him.
We tell the extraordinary story of Paul Burrell, from servant to celebrity. Today, Paul Burrell is one of the most visible figures in royal commentary. His 10 years as butler to Princess Diana still generate endless fascination and secure numerous TV bookings, including popular daytime TV shows.
Joining me now is Princess Diana's former butler, Paul Burrell, of course, one of the people who knew her best of all. Morning, Paul.
Can you believe it's been that long, Janet?
I can't believe
it's that long.
I think in Britain, we love a character. He's incredibly colourful. He's very emotive. And, of course, he offers insight that a lot of people can't necessarily give.
Having served as butler to Princess Diana, Paul became a household name, with the public eager to hear every detail of his life as a royal servant.
Princess Diana made Paul Burrell famous, but Paul Burrell kept himself in the public eye for many decades and years thereafter.
Paul's celebrity status grew through several high-profile TV appearances. Today, he shares aspects of his domestic world with his Instagram followers. He lives in a mock Tudor mansion in Cheshire, from where he also sometimes films video messages revealing more details of his life with the royals.
I've been thinking about all those parties which I attended with the royal family through the years. Parties with the Queen, fancy dress balls at Balmoral, family parties with Princess Diana, and parties celebrating the life of the princess.
But his 21st century life is in stark contrast to younger brothers. The younger of them, Graham, has agreed to share details of their childhood.
Well, we were three boys in a terraced house, two up, two down. Dad worked 7 days a week, 12 hours a day. Mum was always there. We shared a bedroom together. We had bath time together on a Sunday night in Tim Bath.
The young Paul found a form of escape from his surroundings in the glamorous world of Hollywood.
I remember as a child, there were always a poster up on the wall from his film magazine. He'd have a picture of Bette Davis or a picture of Elizabeth into his bedroom wall as we were children.
There was something about Paul that was always being led to a different life.
Aged 12, Paul Burrell came face to face with a world entirely unlike his own on a family trip to London.
We always went to Palace, and we always went to see Busby's, and on this particular time, we were all holding railings, three little boys from Derbyshire, and Paul said to Mum and Dad, one day I'm going to work there. Dad ruffled. Diana said, yeah, of course you are, son.
After leaving school at 16, Paul studied for a diploma at Catering College. Upon graduating, he worked briefly in hotels on the South Coast until a previous application to the royal household yielded a job offer. In 1976, at just 18, Paul Burrell began work as 14th footman to the Queen. This photo from his Instagram page shows him in Windsor Castle, but much of his time was spent at Buckingham Palace.
When Paul did actually get the job at Buckingham Palace, it were unreal. We were stood looking at the most famous house in the land. It gave us a doorway into a world that was so far from where we lived. It were a world of fantasy.
It was like living a fairy tale in many ways for him. I think he had to pinch himself from time to time.
We used to drive down, going to Buckingham Palace, sit in his bedroom window looking down the mall. And that was so exciting.
Within 16 months of starting at the palace, he was promoted to personal footman to the Queen.
And she'd apparently said, who is that young man? And she'd been told, and she said, well, he seems to be very good at what he does. Let's try him out. And I think she was looking for a new footman. So, I mean, she doesn't have very many, and she doesn't have very many men in that close area. But, you know, Paul Burrell, in a very short time, became one of the key male servants in the Queen's life.
Once promoted, the Queen tested Paul Burrell with a job very close to her heart.
Burrell was thrown in at the deep end. The first thing she said to him was, oh, do you like dogs? And he said, I love dogs, Your Majesty. Well, let's see if they like you. But Paul was quite practical. At breakfast that morning, he'd wrapped up because he thought they might come in useful if he had to sort of placate the corgis. His secret weapon came in very handy because he managed to sort of rush off after the dogs behind some trees and dish out their treats to them. And after that, of course, they wouldn't leave him alone.
It went until I actually stood in Royal Enclosure at Royal Ascot and seen the carriage drive swoop into Royal Enclosure and saw Paul sat up back at carriage directly behind Queen, that it hit me like a ton of bricks that my brother was so close to Her Majesty.
As her personal footman and chief corgi walker, Paul Burrell was one of the Queen's top servants. The images he posts online illustrate the pride he took in his job. But like all staff members, Paul would have been made very aware of his standing. Di Davis, who served the royals from 1994 to 98 as head of Scotland Yard Royalty Protection Force, remembers well the boundary between the royals and their staff.
I think Her Majesty, she has seen so many servants, police officers, private secretaries come and go. All of us who work with and for the royal family have to remember our place. We're there to support them. We're not there to be their best friends.
Whilst Paul may have been kept busy with his duties for the Queen, he still found time to help out the newest addition to the royal family. In 1981, Diana Spencer was living at Buckingham Palace in the months leading up to her wedding to Prince Charles.
This other member of staff called Mark Simpson had got close to the princess, and he was taking her Big Macs. And so he pulled Paul Burrell in to be part of this mission. And so they went to a local McDonald's and they brought back Big Macs and fries.
And they apparently sat and had it together. And that's Diana. I think she could mix with everybody.
But whilst Paul was becoming popular upstairs, it would be downstairs that romance blossomed.
Paul met his wife, Maria, who was a maid to Prince Philip, while they were making the Queen's bed.
He and Maria did break new ground, because normally what happens when below-stairs staff marry was that one of them, at least, has to stop working.
Paul happened to mention this to the Queen one day, and the Queen said, well, that can't be right. You and Maria deserve to stay on.
Although today Paul is strongly associated with Lady Diana, it was originally his wife Maria who bonded with the princess and secured Paul's future with the newest royal.
Sometimes she would pop down to a little tiny mews flat, which is at the back of Buckingham Palace where all the servants lived, and she would, you know, drop in to see Maria as well. So slowly, this sort of relationship was building.
So Princess Diana and Maria, so sharing their experiences and bonding over that new life.
By the mid-80s, when Diana and Charles needed more staff at Highgrove, their Gloucestershire residence, Diana made an offer to Maria, not Paul.
Diana in sort of appealing to Maria to think about the future, and you can't carry on living in this pokey little flat. Why don't you come and work for us?
And with pressure from Diana and a lot more pressure from Maria about a new life in the countryside, they managed to persuade Paul about the benefits of family life at Highgrove.
Although initially reluctant to leave the Queen's service, in 1987, Paul relented to pressure from Diana and his wife by moving to Highgrove to become butler to the Prince and Princess of Wales.
And I don't blame him in one sense. You know, they were the future, as it were, or she was the future. And the potential future queen, why wouldn't an ambitious servant want to be on the right side, as it were?
But as Paul began on the exciting new chapter in his life, words of warning echoed in his ears.
Just before he left, he was taken aside by a very senior figure at Buckingham Palace, who said to him, Paul, there is something you need to know about the Charles and Diana household. All is not as it seems.
In 1987, Paul Burrell found himself working for possibly the most high-profile royal couple in living memory, the Prince and Princess of Wales. Based at Highgrove, he was a highly valued butler, but relations between Charles and Diana were strained.
All the staff in the royal household knew that Prince Charles was carrying on a years-long affair with Camilla Parker Bowles. Princess Diana is first absolutely suffering and devastated, and then very slowly begins to try to find love and friendship in other places.
With a growing divide between Charles and Diana, the princess drew on close friends for comfort. The photos Paul shares on social media from this time reflect the increasingly personal relationship he was developing with her.
Many times when we visited, there'd be a knock at door. You'd open the door and Princess would be stood there. I watched the friendship grow. She was calm around Paul. They were good together. Paul knew what she wanted before she wanted it.
Paul soon found himself in a more trusted relationship with his employer than he had ever had working for the Queen at Buckingham Palace.
She didn't have a husband who could talk to her, so she would talk to Paul. When she started to call him her emotional washing machine, she would dump all her innermost thoughts and emotions on him.
Before long, Diana was asking Paul to enable her own extramarital relationships, in particular with former army captain James Hewitt, who had been Diana's horse riding instructor.
There was one time when Diana asked him to go and pick up James Hewitt, take him to Highgrove even, which is quite astonishing.
So Burrell put him in the back of a car underneath a blanket. And I mean, whether it really worked, it's highly unlikely because there are police all over the estate at Highgrove.
The marriage problems of Charles and Diana soon became public when the Prime Minister made an unprecedented announcement.
It is announced from Buckingham Palace that, with regret, the Prince and Princess of Wales have decided to separate.
As Diana and Charles discussed separation practicalities, the Princess made an astonishing demand.
Charles said, well, you know, whatever you want, just take it and go. And she said, well, what I want is, I want Paul.
From 1992, Paul Burrell became butler solely to Diana, based out of Kensington Palace.
It's interesting to speculate on how that felt for Paul Burrell. Did he feel that he was stepping away from the real heart of the royal family, so away from the Queen, away from Prince Charles, away from the blood heirs of the English monarchy? Or did he feel the opposite, that actually Princess Diana was clearly the superstar, obviously far and away much more charismatic and interesting than any of the other royals?
Diana ran her household much more informally than any other royal. The normal hierarchy of servants was ignored, and whoever was closest to Diana personally would rise to the top.
She was falling out with people, staff were coming and going. The only sort of constant in it all, at least to me on the outside looking in, seemed to be Paul Burrell.
Before long, both Diana's private secretary and her other butler, Harold Brown, left her service. Candid photos from Paul's Instagram feed reveal how Diana even started to become a feature of Paul's social life. In 1994, she attended his wife Maria's 40th fancy dress birthday party. But as their lives became ever more entwined, Diana started to rely on Paul more and more.
She started leaving notes about her life, her thoughts, asking him for advice on all manner of things.
Paul has given the public glimpses of these notes through social media.
He was definitely now being pulled into things that a butler wouldn't ordinarily see unless invited.
In recent years, Paul has been publicly questioned over whether the relationship with Diana was more like that between friends than employer and employee.
The thing was, of course, she shouldn't have let me come that close because there's a line.
Exactly, your terminology. It's interesting that you know the line.
Did he allow himself to cross that boundary? Yes, I suspect he probably did. I understand that if he had turned down the sort of extracurricular stuff that he was now doing for her, well, where would that leave him? He worked in Kensington Palace. He saw the revolving door of staff being turfed out who sort of fell out of favour.
She needed someone else by her side. She needed someone to look after her and to give her attention, and she approached the world through her feelings. So if she didn't feel loved or cared for in the moment, she would possibly feel very, very insecure and sad. But I just have a little sense that what bonded them was Diana's need to be loved and Paul's need to be loved.
In 1996, the Prince and Princess of Wales divorced, meaning Diana was officially no longer a member of the royal family. With Diana now free to use her international profile however she chose, Paul Burrell's role once again stepped up to a new level. On now iconic tours to Angola and Bosnia in aid of landmine charities, Paul travelled with her in a role that transcended his title of butler.
He was wearing many hats. He was PR, he was chauffeur, he was private secretary, he was butler. He was everything rolled into one, which I think speaks to how much she relied on him and how much she trusted him.
I remember that tour to Angola in particular. You know, we were all there for the famous shot of the princess walking through the minefield. And, you know, and there's Burrell in a Ralph Lauren shirt, same as the princess. And you're thinking, this guy now really is very important in her life.
1997 was not only the peak of Diana's public profile, it was also the pinnacle of Burrell's career as a servant. The press described him as the most important person in her life.
Gushing newspaper profiles, I should know, I wrote some of them, about who was this remarkable man. You know, boyfriends may come and go, but one man's constant step forward, Paul Burrell, and I think he rather enjoyed it.
Paul soon became known as Diana's rock.
I mean, a lot of people have said to me, well, he wasn't the only person she referred to as her rock. There are a number of other people. Well, that may be the case. But what I can say is that it didn't come from Burrell. I didn't hear it first from Burrell. It probably came from Diana.
Paul has subsequently claimed in TV appearances he was not only her rock, but also Diana's best friend.
I was her best friend. I was a great advisor on what to wear and when to wear it. I did great flower arrangements.
I think the friendship were greater than they thought at the time, if that makes sense. I think it were great when you look back at it, when you're actually travelling through it.
I don't think he was her best friend. I think that's a misunderstanding. I think that's something that he subsequently came to in the years after her death.
But since her death, he has revealed them too. One of the most sensational was a letter she wrote just 10 months before the tragic accident that took her life.
In 2003, Paul revealed the existence of a letter that Diana had written a couple of months after her divorce from Charles, saying that she thought Charles wanted to kill her.
This letter was given to Paul, he says, as insurance, and it was in Diana's hand.
But Diana was paranoid about these things. I mean, Burrell, I think it's best to reassure her. The fact that she confided in him about it, I wasn't entirely surprised. I mean, she told me some of this stuff too. She got Burrell to pull up all the carpets on one occasion and even lift floorboards to see if they could find bugs, but they never found anything at all, of course.
Only months after Diana wrote this letter to Paul on August 31st, 1997, he received news that brought his life as a royal servant to an unexpected and gruesome end.
I was actually with Paul at Kensington Palace. We was woke in the early hours of the morning with police knocking at the door. I remember seeing policemen in Paul's hallway, Paul on telephone. Comes off telephone, said that Princess had been injured. They were like a rabbit in headlights. Everything, his job, his best friend, everything were in jeopardy.
The driver and Dodi Al-Fayed died at once. The security man and Diana initially both survived, though ambulancemen spent 2 hours with her at the scene. They were brought here to the Pitié Salpêtrière Hospital, but such was the gravity of Diana's injuries, they pronounced her dead at 4 a.m. Paris time.
Upon hearing of Princess Diana's death in Paris, Paul left to perform one final royal duty. He arrived before Charles or any other royal and began arranging for her to be brought back to Britain.
They just wanted to take care of all loose ends and make sure everything was in order and protect her dignity.
After her televised funeral in Westminster Abbey, Paul was one of only two non-family members invited to Diana's private burial at the family estate, Althorpe. But perhaps the greatest honour for Paul in the months after Diana's death was his involvement in her memorial fund. He would explain in TV interviews how this was a way of protecting her memory.
For me, it's a way of carrying forward what I began 10 years ago, looking after the princess in a private way. I can now look after the princess in a public way.
While being employed by the Memorial Fund to arrange charitable work, Paul Burrell appeared at events as Diana's representative.
The press got more interested in Paul after Princess's death because he was more...
And instead of standing there with a tray serving champagne, someone is standing in front of you with a tray serving you champagne.
By the middle of 1998, Paul Burrell had carved out a place for himself in public life as the spokesperson for Princess Diana's work and ideals. But with his public profile rising, what was more important to Princess Diana's former butler?